Welcome to part 4 of a lecture on competing reactions. Subject of today are problems with introducing a side chain, for instance, late in within a synthesis. First of all, a model reaction with a simple starting structure. Obviously, this is a conjugate addition process, and the metal of choice for something like that is, of course, copper. Typical organo-copper chemistry. So, and with lithium dimethyl cuprate, with additional lithium bromide in there, in diethyl ether at minus 15 degrees, this reaction proceeds smoothly, and after hydrolysis, you will obtain this molecule as a mixture of diastereoisomers with an 85% yield. And this reaction has been a model reaction in the group of Larry Overman at the UC Irvine. We've heard a lot of Larry Overman. We had a couple of examples from his group. And well, the structure, this was the test reaction for, looked like that. So, here we have the alpha beta unsaturated ketone, but now there is annihilated an additional bicyclic ring system. Which of course causes a lot of steric hindrance here. So, and well, although the methyl group is of course the minimal side chain, just a methyl group. Nevertheless, same reaction conditions, and even applying these tricks, I think, adding, for instance, BF3 etherate, adding an additional Lewis, it just didn't work. The methyl group could not be introduced here with copper reagents. Alternatively, we also tried a protocol with dimethyl zinc and nickel aquac as catalyst, and it didn't work either. So, how did they solve then the problem? They applied a certain reagent. It was Nagata's reagent. And this is diethyl aluminum cyanide, a nice, good working reagent for the hydrocyanation of alpha beta unsaturated ketones. So instead of a methyl group, they introduced a cyano group with the following result. And this was obtained with an 87% yield. Well, okay, it's just a one carbon, nucleophilic one carbon building block that was introduced, and the cyanide is of course the smallest from the sterically hindrance, the smallest one we could imagine. Well, okay, it's just the wrong oxidation state. That's it. So we have to reduce the cyano group, and in addition, in the final product, the Overman group also had to reduce that carbonyl group to an alcohol. Okay, so powerful reducing agent is lithium aluminum hydride and THF, and this time at higher temperature, not minus 78, but in this case plus 75 degrees. So let us think about what happened here. The hydride will react very rapidly, of course, with that primary alcohol. Okay, the first equivalent of hydrides will be consumed here. Yeah. Then with the carbonyl group, and then with the cyanide group. Okay, so, well, let's see what is the result in this case. After the cyanide is reduced first to the imine, then because that OH group is on the same side as the imine, a reaction takes place. And yeah, aminal is formed. Okay, so let's draw that. So let's abbreviate that one here. Yes, this should be right. Okay. So, now we are at the oxidation state of an aldehyde in this position. Do you know any possibility how to reduce such a carbonyl group, an aldehyde or ketone completely until the stage of the hydrocarbon? Classical reactions from organic chemistry too. There are two, Clemmensen and Wolff-Kishnoff. The Clemmensen is in acidic solution, HCl and zinc, and Wolff-Kishner is hydrazine and under basic reaction conditions. So the Wolff-Kishner reduction conditions, it's of course hydrazine as the hydrochloride. Well, what will happen? So, this functional group is in equilibrium, will also open up again and will be trapped by the hydrogen, and then ammonium will be eliminated. So, then with ethylene glycol in the presence of potassium hydroxide, 195 degrees, heating that up in a pressure tube, of course, delivered 74% of the final product, okay, so 74%. Well, we should have a closer look to those reaction conditions. 74%, I think, is quite okay. So, as I said, this is a Wolff-Kirchner reduction. So, and what is the mechanism of a Wolff-Kirchner reduction? First of all, we have the formation. Well, doesn't matter is it ketone or an aldehyde, it works with both. We have the formation of a hydrazone. Then, treatment with a base. In this case, the potassium hydroxide. Then, a base-induced tautomerization occurs. And next step, again with the base, it's deprotonated a second time. And now, nitrogen is eliminated, forming a carbon and iron here, which will be soon protonated again. Giving rise to the hydrocarbon. So, of course, this anion is very short-lived. Within the solvent, and it's protic solvent, there's some water in there, catalytically at least, and, of course, the ethylene glycol. By the way, the ethylene glycol modification is called the Huang-Minlon. So, Wolff-Kirchner reduction as Huang-Minlon, Minlon modification. So, the yields are already quite good, but having to apply very high temperature of 195 degrees is, of course, somewhat a disadvantage. Right? So, therefore, in the last 30 years or so, some more modifications have been developed to get this reaction done with even higher yield under more moderate reaction conditions. So, interesting is the Cram modification. Here with a nice example. Initially from camphor synthesizing the hydrazone of camphor. In this case, you have to isolate that hydrazone and let it drop slowly to a solution of dry DMSO and potassium t-butoxide sublimed prior to use. It has to be completely dry. Then this is an astonishing basic solution, and the reaction smoothly proceeds already at room temperature. Sixty-four percent have been isolated. Not excellent, the yield. And the Cram modification has not found that widespread application since there are competing reaction in here. Because in equilibrium, these hydrazones will react to form. Oh, sorry. These azines. And this smoothly occurs with a bit of silica and moisture, but even just let it stand there at room temperature, sometimes also at lower temperature. And it's clear with those azines that Wolff-Kishner reduction doesn't work anymore. Remember the mechanism. There is nothing we could deprotonate here. Okay? So, isolating those hydrozones is a bit a problem. You have to be fast. And there is the so-called Henbest modification, which you can try. It's easier to set that up. It's then potassium t-butoxide in toluene. You can try that as a one-pot procedure, not isolating those hydrozones, but since potassium t-butoxide is not as basic in toluene as it is in dry DMSO, you have to go up with the temperature, and this is then 111 degrees, it's reported. Well, I don't know why 111 degrees. I think from toluene, wasn't it 115 degrees, the boiling point? Well, okay, 111, yeah? Okay, I thought 115, yeah, okay. And it's just reflux. So, and the yield then is at around 80 degrees. I found the Myers modification from 2004. Very interesting. It's a clear improvement. So, what Myers is doing, having that ketone, and of course, nearly all new methods are sooner or later introduced at a steroid framework. Yeah, but I just save the time and drawing the steroid. It works excellently. So, that no one can say I made a mistake with the steroid framework. It was like that. Not four rings of a steroid, but there is a fifth ring there, okay? So, okay. And how does this work? He is using a hydrazine derivative. silyl substituted, and it is again the tertiary butyl dimethyl silyl group, which we all know is it's difficult to hydrolyze it off. Yesterday we had an example with that TBDMS group sitting at an oxygen, and we had to use the fluoride. Yeah, so silica gel or something like that doesn't affect that. Okay, at the nitrogen it is more sensitive, and this is of course wrong. The TBS group is directly sitting here at the nitrogen. So, and how is this synthesized? Very simple. Dry, pure hydrazine, not the 50% solution in water. You add just this to it and heat it up without any solvent to about 70 degrees. And in rather short time, if I could remember it correctly, about 2 to 3 hours, it completely has reacted. And secondly, just distilling at the Kugelrohr. And you will receive that with 79% and absolutely stable over years in the fridge. So, also, this stuff can form a hydrazone and then a silyl, monosilyl substituted hydrazone, which then does not further on react to give azines. This is no problem anymore. The only problem is the initial step, because this is far less reactive for imine formation with the ketone. You have to activate the ketone, but this nicely works with catalytic amounts of scandium triflate. Okay, then you have that silyl substituted hydrazone first, and secondly, it's just again potassium T butoxide DMSO, room temperature 23 degrees, and this has been demonstrated with rather a complex target molecule with an excellent 91% yield. So the Myers modification seems to be right now state of the art. Okay. So let's go to the next example about problems with introducing a side chain And this example is from E.J. Corey's group at Harvard. So, the structure. This time, no model reaction, they just straight on went for the real thing. And they tried to introduce the side chain just here at that carbonyl. Here we have a CH3 group, here we have a TMS group. So, there is that quaternary center directly adjacent to that carbonyl group and in close proximity, a big TMS group. Well, there is steric hindrance. And, well, one would try to apply, of course, an organometal reagent, that one, organomagnesium or organolithium, or if it doesn't want to, one would go for organocerium, of course. Nothing happened in that case. Well, a lot of things will have happened. Yeah? Those competing reactions we will discuss in due course, also today. Yeah? But it didn't go to that compound. Yeah? So, what might be the problem? We have steric hindrance, serious steric hindrance here close to the carbonyl group. And what is often forgotten about is that an organometallic reagent like that is also rather bulky. We have to have a closer look to the structure there. So, let's talk a bit about structure and reactivity of those organometallic species. So, as I said, if nothing works for a 1-2 reaction, one as the ultimate try goes for organocerium, because organocerium has an very high affinity to the carbonyl oxygen. Please remember the so-called Lewis reduction. So, within a Lewis reduction, you can very selectively reduce an alpha beta unsaturated ketone directly at the carbonyl group, and you avoid the conjugate reduction of that system. With normal sodium borohydride and so on, you have a significant amount of, for instance, cyclohexanol. First, conjugate reduction, and then additional reduction of a carbonyl group. Under Lewis conditions, you can avoid that. And here, one example, especially interesting example I found, having this one with the acid side chain. Three equivalents of cerium chloride hydrate. 10 equivalents sodium borohydride. Of course, you need a lot of equivalents, having all that water present. And in methanol, 30 degrees, 30 minutes, what will happen? Selectively, you will produce that allylic alcohol. And then, just with HCl, 6 molar, you will protonate here, having a leaving group there, a nucleophilic center there, and clearly a spirocycle is formed. Like that. Think it's a nice reaction. So, concerning those organocerium compounds, how do you synthesize those? Well, either from organolithium via transmetallation. Organolithium plus cerium 3 chloride. This will give that organocerium compound a true organocerium compound, since we have a carbon cerium bond. For Grignard reagents, treating those with cerium chloride, it is believed that in this case, a complex is formed like that. It's some kind of 8 complex. A magnesium plus and a cerium minus. An 8 complex. You know, 8 complexes and onium complexes. However, in both cases, we have rather similar reactivity. In both cases, the cerium will finally coordinate at the carbonyl group and activate that. However, in this example, it just didn't work. So, let's have a look for structure and reactivity of organomagnesium and organolithium. Just that we remember the most important features. Organomagnesium and organolithium are, of course, both polarized, but not ionic. The metal is covalently bound to the carbon. This is important to keep in mind. And for organomagnesium and organolithium, there is a strong influence of the solvent. Organolithium, depending on the solvent, we have it to do with hexamers, two dimers, here with increasing reactivity. You can imagine the hexamers are rather bulky, with the reactive nucleophilic center somehow protected inside. Dimers, you can get, for instance, with TMEDA, if you add TMEDA, you have the dimer formation. And how does that TMEDA dimer look like? For instance, butyllithium you have these multi-center bonding with, of course, some similarity, for instance, to diborane, with that electron-deficient 3-center 2-electron bond. And here, you have the TMEDA ligands coordinating the lithium atoms, and this is actually the result of a crystal structure analysis. So, far more reactive than the hexamers. For Grignard reagents, it's similarly, if not far more complicated, because of the Schlenk equilibrium. So, and I think better I should draw that on the next blackboard. So, an alkyl or aryl magnesium halide will form in equilibrium a dimer like this. Of course, we should not forget that we have generally as additional ligands ether molecules, diethyl ether or THF. And as you know, even the formation of the Grignard reagents from the element and alkyl and aryl halides doesn't work without the presence of those ethers. Well, okay, with some amines you can also get it done. But you need those additional ligands. What happens in equilibrium? Also, these species will be formed. And dialkyl or diaryl magnesium plus the simple magnesium salt. And also those will form a complex like this, also with additional ligands present. If you minimize the presence of those coordinating ligands, then polymers, coordination polymers, will be formed. That's not all. It was found that Grignard solution are slightly conducting. And this means that there should be an equilibrium with free ions like this. So, and all that is in addition influenced by the solvent molecules, at the same time those ligands. Actually, in THF and in diethyl ether, that core Schlenk equilibrium is on the side of those monoalkyl or aryl magnesium halides. At triethyl amine, the equilibrium goes more to this side, and you can drive that to completion by adding dioxane. In dioxane, that magnesium halide is generally insoluble and will just crystallize out, and then you have this in solution. Okay. And all those species will influence the reaction of the Grignard reagent of the organomagnesium species with the carbonyl compound. So, and as the title of that lecture series is Competing Reactions, what are the competing reactions when you try to let a Grignard reagent react with a carbonyl compound? So, competing reactions at 1,2 addition to carbonyls. Let's see. So, we have those furan or ether ligands coordinated to the Grignard reagent, and in equilibrium, every now and then, such solvent ligand will pop off and is replaced by the oxygen, free electron pairs of the oxygen of the carbonyl oxygen. Okay. So, delta minus here, delta plus there, Lewis acidic. This is basic. And let's count the centers. With a six-member transition state, things are often much easier. So, and let's count the centers. Oxygen, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay. Six-member transition state can lead to the enol, like that. Okay. It's just deprotonating the alpha acidic carbonyl. Second competing reaction very often in cases where the carbonyl group is sterically hindered, for instance, there are some nice examples with air is isopropyl. Just as an example. Let's count the centers. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 in this case. This is the so-called Grignard reduction. So, okay, now let us have a look at to the mechanism of the 1-2 addition itself. So, could it be a simple polar 1-2 addition with a question mark? So, in the undergraduate class, we often draw it like this. We have a delta plus there and a delta minus at the oxygen. On the other hand, delta minus at this R prime and delta plus at the magnesium. So, why not this four-membered transition state like that? Yes, it is a reason. I hope you remember from the discussion of stereoselectivity or diastereoselectivity with those Grignard addition processes, the Burgi-Dunitz angle. That the nucleophile, then, also within Grignard region, does not approach perpendicular, since there is that electronic repulsion with the free electron pairs, but the trajectory of the incoming nucleophile is about 107 degrees. This is the Burgi-Dunitz angle. And it's clear that 107 degree trajectory just doesn't fit into that scheme with a four-member transition state, at least in my opinion. So, there are some cases where SET processes are proven without any doubt. That is, for instance, the case if we have a ketone like that and, for instance, a tertiary butyl magnesium halide, an SET process, so single electron transfer, will then produce such a ketyl radical, and that tertiary butyl radical, which then can recombine to the product, but, well, I would anticipate that in such a case you won't observe a Burgi-Dunitz angle and that selectivity. Well, actually, it is generally assumed that in such processes, addition of a Grignard reagent to a carbonyl group, generally a second molecule of the organomagnesium compound is involved, preferentially with a six-membered transition state. So, I looked that up. What you find as mechanism is first of all this kind of scheme with the centers 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Imagine transition state like that. So this electron pair goes here, this electron pair there, this electron pair to the magnesium. Okay? Essentially, this orientation you will find if you look this mechanism of the Grignard addition up in Wikipedia. Okay, they have a reference to an original article where you don't find that scheme. They somehow got it extracted out it. In the original literature, there is some ESR spectroscopy with radicalic intermediates. However, if you go into a very reliable and good textbook. I like it very much. It's the Boudreaux. So, the Boudreaux gives another orientation, similar but not the same. Not the X up here, but the R group there, the X here, magnesium there, second X there, and here the R group and the centers 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. Okay? This would then react at first to this one with the R group sitting there, here. We called that R prime, right? So then we should consequently go on with that. Here R prime and that final magnesium is this one, giving the same product. What I didn't find in literature, but just wrote it down in preparation of this lecture, is an alternative putting in the magnesium halide here and the dialkyl or diaryl magnesium compound from the Schlenk equilibrium, having again center 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, giving essentially the same product, but having the X instead of the R prime there. Here again, an exchange has to take place. So, this is certainly also an alternative, and since what is going on in solution while doing a Grignard reaction is so complicated, who knows which is the preferred one? Maybe all of those are going on inside there. But now, after cleaning the blackboard, I will tell you the interesting solution to Curry's problem. Despite all those chances within for different species within the Schlenk equilibrium and organolithium compounds, as you remember, nothing worked for, there. It doesn't want to react, okay? How did they solve the problem? Again, with a Grignard reagent. But what they made use of is this one. An allyl magnesium halide. So, what is different with an allyl magnesium halide compared to the other examples? The difference is, in that case, you just need one single molecule of Grignard reagent to let a reaction start again with a six-member transition state. Since in this case, it should be an SN2 prime reaction with this one as the nucleophilic center. So, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, six-member transition state. And it's done. So, since you only need one molecule of Grignard reagent participating, it's less sensitive, the allyl magnesium compound, less sensitive in view of steric hindrance. So, let us finally go briefly through the final steps of a synthesis in Corey's group. They managed to get an allyl group in rather nicely, and nicely means 99% yield. TMS, and well, to save some time, I will skip all those substituents down here. They don't play any role in the final transformation. So, this allyl group had to be transformed later on into that target sidechain. So, here they first introduced an alcohol functionality by a hydroboration and oxidation. And of course protected it. Here still the TMS group. Here, the OH group. This methyl group is still important. Next step, they were in need of a skeletal rearrangement, because what they were aiming for is this one, having the methyl group there and the OH group there. How did they achieve that? Well, okay, they activated that OH group with BF3 in dichloromethane, forming the tertiary cation, and the Wagner-Merwein rearrangement occurred. Methyl group migrated from here to there. Therefore, that side chain ended up on the other side. And the driving force also is that the TMS group pops off, gives electron density to form that olefin then. Marvelous, I think. Well, okay, and the final steps are a nice protocol, triphenylphosphine iodide, and imidazole readily transforms primary alcohols in those alkyl iodides. Here, those other substituents there. And now, to get to that group, well, a C3 unit. We are in need of a C3 unit. Okay, where do we get that from? 2-bromopropene. Then, tibuli to form the organol lithium. Those who already attended stoichiometric organometallics should know that in this case, generally, you will have to apply 2 equivalents of a tertiary butyl lithium, because the tertiary butyl bromide will react very fast with a second tertiary butyl lithium, forming lithium bromide, isobutene, and isobutane. Okay, so therefore you need the second tertiary butyl lithium, and with isopropyl lithium, the reaction with that the nucleophilic substitution here won't work that good. No, in that case, again, you need a more nucleophilic one. Organocuprate. So, you will form an organocuprate with it, and then you will successfully introduce that isopropyl group at the end. And now let us draw all the other substituents there. Okay, and that last step. So with the iodide 797, and the same yield also for that nucleophilic cuprate reaction. So I think that was a fascinating reaction, and it was worthwhile to go through some details of organometallic reagents, especially organomagnesium chemistry. Thank you for listening. See you next week on Tuesday.